In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, one God. Amen. We thank our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ for another Bible Preach session this blessed Friday. And all the way from Sydney, Australia, we pray that all of those who are with us here in the church and those who are watching us through live streaming are always in good health and in good spirit in Jesus' mighty name. And I want to hear an amen. Amen. All right, let's stand for the Lord's Prayer, please. In the name of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, one God, amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgave our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Psalm 53. The fool has said in his heart, there is no God. They are corrupt and have done abominable iniquity. There is none who does good. God looks down from heaven upon the children of men to see if there are any who understand, who seek God. Every one of them has turned aside. They have together become corrupt. There is none who does good, no, not one. Have the workers of iniquity no knowledge, who eat up my people as they eat bread and do not call upon God? There they are in great fear where no fear was, for God has scattered the bones of him who encamps against you. You have put them to shame because God has despised them. Oh, that the salvation of Israel would come out of Zion. When God brings back the captivity of his people, let Jacob rejoice and Israel be glad. Amen. And all glory be to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated. Well, a very warm welcome to everyone. How are we? Are we good? Are we good? Are you sure? Where is everyone? They're still hiding, eh? We used to have full people in here. What's going on? Once that Corona came, the mother of Corona, people sort of, hopefully they're going to start coming back gradually after all this ordeal that we've been going through for the past 2 years. I pray you guys are always good, close to the Lord Jesus, regardless of what's happening in the world and what's happening in our life. We need to entrust everything to the Lord's capable hands. Amen? All right, we're going to continue our journey and our commentary on the book of Revelation. And today we are going to be reading from Revelation chapter 5, verses 1 to 6. So, Revelation 5 verses 1 to 6. And I saw in the right hand of him who sat on the throne a scroll written inside and on the back, sealed with seven seals. Then I saw a strong angel proclaiming with a loud voice, "Who is worthy to open the scroll and to loose its seals?" And no one in heaven or on the earth or under the earth was able to open the scroll or to look at it. So I wept much, because no one was found worthy to open and read the scroll, or to look at it. But one of the elders said to me, "Do not weep. Behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, has prevailed to open the scroll and to loose its seven seals." And I looked, and behold, in the midst of the throne and of the four living creatures, and in the midst of the elders, stood a lamb as though it had been slain, having seven horns and seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God sent out into all the earth. And all glory be to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ forever and ever. Amen. Well, we are now in chapter 5 of Revelation. Chapter 4, just to sum up, chapter 4 was talking about the divine God, divinity. Chapter 5 is going to talk about the divine God revealed in humanity. So when you read chapter 4, it is talking only about God the divine, before putting on the flesh. Before putting on the flesh, God the spiritual, the spirit, God the spirit, the divine. In chapter 5, the word is incarnate. God is in the flesh. God has come to do his work through the flesh, through the flesh. So chapter 4, divinity before the incarnation. Chapter 5, divinity revealed in the flesh as Jesus Christ of Nazareth. When we look at verse 1, it says, "And I saw in the right hand of him." Who is him? The one who is sitting on the throne. Because when we talked about chapter 4, there was one sitting on the throne. The one who is sitting on the throne is the King of all kings and the Lord of all lords. It is God himself sitting on his throne as the King. So God in his divinity is King. In his humanity is a priest. God in his divinity, he is the King. In his humanity, he is the priest and he is the high priest, as St. Paul tells us in his epistle to the Hebrews. So, and I saw at the right hand of him. Of him, he is referring to chapter 4. John the Beloved is referring to chapter 4. The one who was sitting on the throne before putting the flesh on. So the one who was sitting on the throne in chapter 4 is God himself. And I saw at the right hand of him who is sitting on the throne, at his right hand, who sat on the throne, I saw a scroll written inside and on the back, sealed with 7 seals. He saw what? At the right hand of the one who sits on the throne, he saw a scroll. In the good olden days, the Holy Bible was thousands of papers rolled up, scrolls. The Holy Bible was not the way we have it now and we are used to seeing it now. It is one book and this book is all in order and the book has chapters and has numbers. Before, no. Before it was scrolls and thousands of them everywhere. And before, the Holy Bible had neither chapters nor numbers. It was one unit. So if you wanted to find a word in the Holy Bible, you had to read the entire Bible from Genesis to Revelation to find the word because there were no chapters, no numbers. Very hard to find a word in it. Today, you Google it up and it's gonna tell you which chapter, which book, which verse, which page in a press of a button. So he saw a scroll on the right hand of the one who sits on the throne. And this scroll, it was written inside and on the back of it, and it was sealed with 7 seals. So it was written on the inside and the back of it. Normally, when they used to write in those days on that scroll, they would write on one side of it. Why? Because the other side would be rolled. So the empty side was left on the external side. But the writing, to be protected and preserved, they used to roll it inside, inward. So the outside was empty. But this scroll is different. This scroll has writing inside and on the back, meaning on the outside as well. In other words, the writings were on both sides of the scroll. Now please pay attention. I want you to be with me. Now what is written on in this scroll? words. Now, which word is this? It is the word of the one who sits on the throne. Who is sitting on the throne? God himself. So it is the word of God that is written on the scroll. Where was the scroll found? At the right hand of the one who sits on the throne. Now, the one who sits on the throne, we said, is God. Now, the question is, does God have a right hand and a left hand? Of course not. God is spirit, and God is everywhere. God has neither right nor left hand. God is spirit and everywhere. So what does it mean, or what does John the Beloved mean when he say the scroll was at the right hand of the one who sits on the throne? Right hand of God, power, mightiness, exaltation, elevation. So he's saying that this scroll, which is the word of God, I saw it at the highest place, at the most powerful place, at the most exalted place, at the most elevated place you could ever think of. Meaning, the word of God, no one can touch, no one can change, no one can get to. It is protected. It is a place where only God can reach. Another thing. The right hand, on the other hand, the right hand also means holiness, means light, means life, means purity, means charity. What did the Lord Jesus say once? He said, when you are doing a charitable deed, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing. When you're doing a charitable deed, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing. So right hand, charity. And what is charity? Charity can only be made possible when there is love. Charity can only be made possible when there is genuine love. So right hand, love, L-O-V-E, all capital letters. But coming back to this, this scroll was at the right hand of the one who sits on the throne. So it is the word of God that is the most elevated, most powerful, most exalted, and the mighty of all. It is the sovereign authority of God. His word cannot be touched, cannot be scathed, cannot be changed. It is preserved and protected by God. We do not look after God. We do not look after his word and try to protect his word. God, the one whom we worship, is more than enough capable of looking after himself and protecting his own word. Therefore, we don't need to fight for him. He does all the fighting for us. Now, this scroll, you're not in a rush, are you? Good. This scroll was at the right hand of the one who sits on the throne, God the King. It was sealed with seven seals. The number seven in the Holy Bible, and we're going to see number seven appearing a lot of time being repeated in the book of Revelation. The number seven, biblically speaking, it means perfect. It refers to perfection. Seven is a full cycle, 7 days a week. It's a complete cycle. So number seven refers or resembles perfection or symbolizes perfection. So this word, it is sealed with perfection. And please let me know when it gets hot in the church, or we can turn the aircon on. Is it hot now? Usually my presence is just hot, you know. I had to throw that one in. I'm hot. They named Sizzler after me and it went bankrupt. Coming back. This word, which is written on the scroll, why is it written inside and out? Because it is sealed with seven seals, meaning His word is complete. There is nothing empty. What God revealed to humanity is the perfect word of God. So the Holy Bible is that scroll. The Holy Bible is the perfect word of God revealed to humanity, but it is neither the first nor the last word of God. God always speaks throughout generations and throughout history, but it is the perfect and complete word of God. You cannot find nothing wrong or short in it. It is sealed with a seven seal, meaning it is complete, it is perfect, written inside and on the back. There is nothing missing out in it. This word, now I need your attention. This word was given to the first creation of God called Adam. And please, if anybody says to you that Genesis from chapter 1 to 11 is symbolic, they are mistaken. It is not symbolic. Adam and Eve is a real story, not an imagination of Moses. This word was given to Adam, the first creation of God. This word comes from someone who is infinite in his being, who is perfect in his being, who is complete in his being, who is holy in his being. It comes from someone that can never ever change his mind the moment he speaks out. It comes from someone, he will never go back on his word, and when his word goes out, it will never come back empty. It will harvest whatever it needs to harvest. It comes from the being who can never ever change. He gave this word to Adam. He said, Adam, I'm gonna give you a choice. You decide for yourself because you are my son. And since you are my son, I created you on the basis of love. And with love, I gave you freedom. And with freedom, I gave you choices and options. And with the options, I gave you the will. It is the most powerful, one of the most powerful tools God ever gave the human race, called the will. You choose to say yes or to say no. You choose to walk this way or that way. You choose to accept or reject, including God. You can stop God. You can, C-A-N. You can stop God from interfering with your life. God has given you this, no one else. And since God will never change his mind, will never go back on his word, what he's given will never be taken away. But that is a problem. In a good way, it's a problem. We need to make a choice, my beloved. Do you want to live in a world that has no love in it? Do you want to live in a world that you are not free in it? What is happening? Why are people going out on riots? For what? Freedom. Has anyone taken notice of this? The question is, we need to ask ourselves, why are you fighting for your freedom? Who gave you this freedom? Who made you to be free? Who told you to fight for your freedom? Who? Have you been taught in primary school, high school, university, a subject called freedom? No. You've been taught everything but freedom. Where do you get it from? Definitely not the Big Bang. Because the Big Bang in itself has no brain. Somebody controlled it. There was a brain that made the Big Bang go boom. This being is the creator who sits on the throne as the king, the king. This king is Jesus Christ. He is your God. He is your creator. He said to Adam, since you're my son, I created you on the basis of love. With love, I have to give you freedom. With freedom, I have to give you choices. With choices, I have to give you the will. Now, I'm coming to you, Adam, and I'll say the following. You see this tree? It's called the tree of life. You can eat from it. There are other trees that are good for your physical nourishment. You can eat from them for as long and as much as you want. No problems. But there is one tree, Adam, I will give you a warning based on love, not dictatorship as governments are doing nowadays. Based on love, this tree, the moment you eat from it, surely you shall die. This tree is called the tree of life, the tree of good and evil, the knowledge of good and evil. The tree of the knowledge of good and evil, Adam, do not eat from it, for the day you eat from it, surely you shall die. Meaning, there is no escape. You will kill yourself by yourself. Adam, since he was created by the one who can never change his mind, he chose, based on those options, based on that freedom, based on the foundation of all called love, he chose to do what God forbade him of doing. He broke God's word. The scroll is at the right hand of the one who sits on the throne. That's what I'm trying to get to. He broke God's word. God's word can never be changed because it comes from the being that can never change his word, his mind. Impossible. So he said, Adam, I'm stuck. God is saying this. It's not written. I'm just sort of elaborating, but it's within the Holy Bible. I'm not going out. He's saying, Adam, please be careful. I am really bounded now by my word. The moment I spoke, I am limited to my word. I must fulfill my word. So please, I'm begging you, Adam, whatever you do, do not break my word. Because I can't simply just flick the switch and say, it's all right, don't worry about it. I can't. I must judge you. Please, son, be careful. Do not press the wrong button. Like so many parents, they beg their kids, do not do the wrong thing. My daughter, please. My son, please. I beg you, my husband, my wife, my brother, my sister, my mom, my dad, I beg you, do not do the wrong things. Please, I'm begging you. It's not that I am afraid of you. It's not that I am in need of you, but it's because I love you. That's why I'm begging you, do not press the wrong button. Adam chose to press the wrong button and ate from the forbidden tree. What happens now? God's word is eternal. God's word cannot be changed. It comes from the one who cannot change neither his mind nor his being. The moment he ate from the tree, the word of God that went forth prior said, the day you eat from this forbidden tree, Adam, surely you shall die. Adam ate, Adam had to die. Because the one who spoke was God, no one else. The never-changing God. The scroll that was placed at the right hand of the one who sits on the throne is the will of God and the judgment of God. The Holy Bible is the will of God and the judgment of God at the same time. God willed it for his word to go forth and reach the human race. He wanted, he chose to do so. So it was the will of God for his word to be written. He willed it. But since he wrote it, and because the word cannot change, the word has to judge whoever is going to break it. I hope you're with me. The word must judge whoever is going to break it. One day, this person approached me who was non-Christian. I'm not going to mention which religion, with all love and respect to all the religions out there. By the way, Christianity is not a religion in the sense of a religion. Because the moment you invoke the word religion, automatically you are invoking a set of rules, guidelines, regulations, and laws. Every religion on the face of this planet, with all love and respect, you go to them, Buddhism, Hinduism, Shintoism, Islamism, every religion on the face of this earth, you go to them, they'll tell you the following. If you want to have a good place in the end, you must do this and this and this and this. If you don't do these, you're going to end up in a bad place. So it's about doing, fulfilling laws, guidelines, rules, and regulations. You don't do them, you're going to end up in hell or somewhere bad. Or you come back the next life as a lesser being. In Christianity, it is not a religion in that sense, because when we go to Jesus Christ, our Lord and God, he will never say you must do this and this and this and this. He will never say this. In fact, the Lord Jesus, in the Gospel of John 15:5, he says, without me, you cannot do nothing, anything. You cannot. Without me, you cannot do anything. So what is Christianity? Christianity is a belief in a person, not set of laws. That is why Christianity is based on love before anything else. Because love can only exist with another being like me. I cannot love a rock. I cannot love, even though we love animals, but I'm talking about an intimate love where the two become one. You cannot marry a dog. You cannot marry a rock. You cannot marry water. You cannot marry any nature that is not yours. You can only relate and establish a relationship with the one who shares the same nature as you, human nature. Love cannot be found in laws, because laws lack love. There is no love in the law. The law says you break the law will break you. There is no love. There is judgment. So you go to a religion that tells you you must obey and do these laws. This religion lacks love. And where there is no love, there is hell. There is no life. What makes life, life, is love. Christ, Christianity, is a belief in a person, not laws. I cannot relate to words, laws. I can only relate to a human being like me. When you accept Jesus Christ as your Lord, as your Savior, as your God, this Jesus Christ whom you have accepted into your life, he will begin to do all the laws that God requires of you. He'll do them through you. Without Jesus, forget it. Because there is no human being that can ever fulfill the law of God. Love your neighbor, love God with all of your heart, soul, strength, and spirit, and love your neighbor like yourself. Has anyone fulfilled this one? God gave Moses 10 commandments. Moses gave the Israelite nation 613 commandments. They could not They could not fulfill none of the 10. Imagine fulfilling 613. Good the luck. You struggled with 10. How are you going to manage 613? The Lord Jesus came. He said, I'm going to give you one law called love. Forget about don't kill, don't steal, don't. Forget about all of them. Forget about all the laws. He says, the day you learn how to love, you will no longer kill. The day you learn how to love, you will no longer steal. The day you learn how to love, you will no longer hurt no one. Because it is love that gives you that ability. So going back to that guy who was non-Christian background, he said, he asked me a few questions and then I came back and I asked him this. I said, when you make a mistake, who are you offending? When you make a mistake, who are you offending? And I'm talking about making a mistake toward a human being, another human being. I said, when you are making a mistake against a human being, who are you offending? He said, that human being. I said, I know, but ultimately, who are you offending? Aren't you offending the author of this being? Who created this human being? If you believe in God, do you? He said, yes. I said, well, if you believe in God, wasn't it God that created this human being? So when you are offending this human being, ultimately you are offending the creator of this being, who is God. So when you've offended God, how is your sin gonna be forgiven? He said, well, God is almighty. From above, he can just take this magical wand, as some said. Feel sorry for them. And from heaven says, I forgive you. You just go to God and say, sorry, God, I've done this. And God from heaven is going to say, I forgive you, because God is almighty. He can do whatever on the spot. I said, do you believe God is love? He said, yes, even though it's not in their religion. Do you believe God is justice? He said, yes. I said, love and justice can never meet. They're two parallel lines. Please just bear with me, yeah? I'm trying to explain this scroll. Love and justice are two parallel lines, can never meet. I said, law, justice is law. When you go to court and you start begging the judge, you've broken the law, you've done something wrong, and you are begging the judge in his courtroom, please, judge, have mercy on me. I made a mistake, I'm so sorry, please forgive me. The law says, the judge will say, but based on this law, in this section, in this rule book, it says, you break, this is your punishment. So therefore, I sentence you to 9 years imprisonment. Because the law doesn't know what mercy is. You break the law breaks you. On the other hand, love. How can love see someone hurting and does nothing? As a parent, you love your children. You adore them. You'll do anything for them. When you see your son or your daughter suffering, and since you love them the most, are you going to be happy seeing your child suffering? Are you going to be comfortable seeing your son lost, your daughter distant from you, from God, from everything, destroying their own life with their own hands? Are you going to be happy? Impossible. Because love only knows one thing, is to love. And when you love, you cannot hurt. You will accept the suffering on yourself but not on your own child. This is love. You will accept that suffering on your own self, but not seeing your own child suffering. This is true love. So love and justice, impossible to meet. So I said, God, is there contradiction in God? Meaning, His love is greater than His justice, His justice or greater than His love. If any of these attributes of God are greater than the other, there is contradiction in God. And since there is contradiction in God, God is changing His mind. I cannot trust, follow, worship a God that changes His mind all the time. It's very dangerous to follow such a God. I need to believe in a God that His word is forever. His promise is eternal. Whatever He says, He will never go back on His word. I want this kind of a God to worship and follow. So when God can never change, what is He gonna do now? His son Adam broke His word. The justice of God is crying out, you must die, Adam. And if that justice is fulfilled, Adam is gonna go to eternal death, totally separated from God forever and ever and ever. But the love of God, on the other hand, is crying out and saying, Adam is my son. I cannot see my son being lost forever without doing anything about it. I'll get up and I will run like crazy to save my son, because I'm his daddy. And daddy is all love for his child. So Adam broke God's word. God said, Adam, I warned you before. If you eat from this tree, surely you shall die. What did He say to him? His word. What is His word? The scroll. What is the scroll? The Holy Bible. What is the Holy Bible? The word of God, which is law, justice. So now justice must be fulfilled. Adam ate, Adam died. But God is love. I'm his dad. I can't let him just disappear like that. The only way to do it is to bring His mercy. His mercy is Jesus Christ of Nazareth. That's where the cross comes into play. God cannot just say a word from heaven, I forgive you, and it's done. If He does that, he has broken His justice. And since God can never change, He cannot allow for His justice to be broken, because He is the perfect holy God. And to let Adam go to hell, He was gonna break His love. Because Adam would have said to God, if you say that you created me on the basis of love, well, where was your love when I went to hell? What has your love done for me? So if Adam is gone to hell, God broke His love. If Adam is brought back and saved and forgiven just from heaven, God broke His justice. God is stuck. I can't let go of my justice, neither I can let go of my love. My love calls him back, my justice sentenced him to eternal death. So I need to do something about it. I'm gonna bring my mercy. Mercy, Jesus Christ of Nazareth hanging on the cross on Calvary, Golgotha. Mercy, now today it's verse 1. Yeah, definitely it's verse 1. Now, please pay attention. Your Christianity is not just a book I read. It's not just a dress I put on. It's not just a cross I hang around my neck. It's not about just going to church. It's not about singing for the Lord and saying, hallelujah, hallelujah, Jesus is here. Get a life. Christianity is a life that must be lived every minute second of your entire life on earth. You need to live it. It's not a theater, an act on a stage. You act and it's the time done, you go. No, you need to live Christ all the time, everywhere, at the same way. You need to behave the way in the church, the same in the street. You need to love the Lord here and out in the street. You need to love the Lord in good times and in bad times. You need to love Jesus Christ always. Always, my beloved, always. Always. Mercy. What is mercy? Mercy can only be made possible, can only exist and be made possible when it is given to someone who has hurt you so badly. Mercy cannot exist in any other category. Mercy can only exist when you show love to someone who has been nothing but a pain in your life. If you show love to someone that loves you, that is not mercy. If you show goodness to someone who is good to you, that is not mercy. But if you show goodness and give love to someone who has nothing but stabbed you in the back, hurt you so badly, and you're still loving them and you're still praying for them, now you are a merciful person. Because mercy is only existent and is only made possible when you give something good to someone who is absolute enemy to you and against you and has given you nothing but grief, pain, and sorrow. When you do that, that is mercy. God came to Adam, and we are all Adam. We broke his word. We went against his will and his wish. We did everything under the sun that was against him. We became his enemy. We became traitors of his law, of his love, traitors of his word. We sold him out for peanuts. And after doing every evil thing under the sun against God, God still came and said, you know what, I'm gonna send you my son. My son will suffer for you on your behalf. My son will be nailed on the cross on your behalf. My son will take your sins and put it on his head, and he will nail it on the cross, and with his precious blood will wash away all of your sins. Why? Because I love you, and the only way to save you, I had to give you my mercy. I gave my mercy to unworthy sinner like me. Jesus died for someone filthy like me. God showed his love for the undeserving. When the Lord came and was nailed on the cross, that is the mercy of God. Now, when you accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, and you make a mistake, not intentionally, but out of human weakness, we are all weak. We made a mistake. I go back to God and I say, God, I made a mistake, I'm sorry. God now has a way of saving me. He says, go to my son. My son will, with his precious blood, is gonna wash away your sin. And when your sin is forgiven, my justice is now fulfilled. And through my love, through that mercy, my love is fulfilled. You'll come back to me as my own son. Nothing is lost. I've given you an analogy long time ago. I'll remind you of it again. I've said this before. Can we just mind the camera for a sec? And I'll say it again. God can't just forgive me just like that out of thin air. It's not that he cannot. He's very powerful, but he is perfect. He will not go against his own self. He will not go against his own self. He's perfect. So now, I gave this analogy to this non-Christian person. I said, let's assume for a moment. Let's speak our language so we can relate. You know, God is too complex. Let's come and be very simple. I said, I'm going to bring a little kid, and I'm going to bring a police officer, and I'm going to bring the president of the most powerful nation in the world. I don't know about Joe Biden, but yeah, it doesn't matter. We need to pray for this guy. Yeah. And we need to pray for this prime minister of I love the Canadian people. I send you my love, my beautiful children. And I pray the Lord Jesus touches the heart of that prime minister of yours because he is acting so foolishly. You need to wake up, Mr. Justin Trudeau, whatever your name is. And don't ever treat your own people like that because you are humiliating yourself. You are becoming a disgrace to your own self because when you treat your own people in such a way, shame on you. And shame on every leader that is like you. Your people are your glory. Your people are your respect. Your people are your honor. Your people are your dignity. You touch them, you're touching your own honor, dignity, and self-esteem. So shame, wake up before it's too late, because Jesus will give you your wish back very soon, my dear friend. Don't get on the nerves of Christ. And let his people live before you receive a message from Jesus. The Lord is merciful, but also he is justice. So I pray that you wake up to yourself, my dear friend. And I'll call you friend, because that's how my Jesus taught me. But you need to wake up. Okay, Mr. Trudeau, you need to wake up. May the Lord Jesus bless all the people in Canada. And I pray that Canada comes back to Christ. I pray all of America come back to Christ, and all of Europe come back to Christ, and away of these globalist nonsense. And let Klaus Schwab go and have his own forums in Davos, Switzerland, and let him eat the dirt of this world. Lost people, they will get the answer from Jesus Christ very shortly. And by the way, Klaus Schwab, you will not get your wish. So if you think you can rule the world and the people who are behind you and the likes of you, that will not be granted, neither to your Satan, neither to you, nor to anyone who is like you. Christ will not allow it. Is that clear? This is the message from the Son of Jesus Christ. The Lord will not allow this evil. He's putting an end to this nonsense. But it's a wake-up call to all humanity to realize there is only one God, and this God, his name is Jesus Christ of Nazareth. There's no one else. So we need to wake up. Come back to Jesus, yeah? Yeah. But Bill Gates, my dear friend, wake up to yourself before you end up where Jeffrey Epstein is. Do you want to know where Jeffrey Epstein is, my dear friend? Bill Gates, do you think I'm joking? Jeffrey Epstein, at this present moment, he is begging God to give him one second chance to come back and repent for what he had done while he was in the flesh on earth, but it is not given to him. Do you think hell is a joke? Do you think God is nothing? Do you think playing with fire, you're not going to be burned? And the Rothschilds, and the BlackRock, and the Rockefeller? Do you think Satan is your savior? Come back to Jesus Christ before it's too late. Because you are not getting what you are wishing for all these centuries. You're not. For as long as I live, that's not going to happen. This is not a show off. This is pride of who my God is. Because when I speak of confidence. Because the one I worship, the one I serve, I know what he's capable of. And I know he hears me. This evil agenda is ended. And all of you will be put to shame including your Satan. So where was I? Bring a little kid, a police officer, and Joe Biden, the most powerful president of the most powerful nation in the world. I said, look, I'm going to smack the little kid. The little kid's going to cry, he's going to hate me. And then I put my hand in my pocket and I bring out a lolly. And I said, hey, Habibi, I love you. Here's a lolly for you, my darling. I'm so sorry. Please forgive me. And here's a lolly for you. The moment he sees the lolly, I'm the best in his eyes. I'm number one. He loves me, he hugs me, he kisses me. I go the same smack. I smack the police officer. And then I put my hand in my pocket and I say, here's a lolly for you, officer. Please forgive me. I'm so sorry. Do you think the police officer is going to accept the chocolate? He's going to put me in that cage, car, and he's going to take me to Fairfield Police Station. I think it's on Smart Street. Anyway, I'll be taken to the police station and they will serve me chocolate their way. Before my hand gets to the face of the president, I am dead meat. What happened? It's the same smack. The little kid, the lolly fixed it. The police officer, police station fixed it. The president, I'm dead. But it's the same smack. What happened? Oh, something's changed. The rank whom I have offended has changed. Here, the rank of a little kid. Here, the rank of a police officer. Here, the rank of a president of the most powerful nation in the world. My punishment is measured according to the rank whom I have offended. When you have offended a human being, who did you offend eventually and above all, the creator of this being, the creator of this human. Who is the creator of this human being? God. What is the rank of God? Infinity. God is infinite. God has no beginning, no end. Neither his beginning has a beginning, nor his end has an end. When I have offended God by breaking his word, my punishment was measured according to the infinite rank of God. Therefore, my debt, my punishment became infinite, eternal. Who's going to come and pay an infinite debt? Angels are finite. They have a beginning. Human beings, finite. They have a beginning. Only one that has no beginning, no end. And this only one being is God. So God had to become man in order to save the human race from eternal death. The mercy of God was the Word was incarnate, born of the Virgin of all virgins, our sweetheart Mother Mary. He came to fulfill the justice of God and to fulfill the love of God by hanging on the cross as the mercy of God. Now, Jesus Christ is the only way of any human being salvation, whether you're a Christian or not. Jesus Christ is the only way. If anyone tells you that all the people and all the religions in the world, they worship God, but each one to their own way, that is a false statement and it's a lie. Not everyone worships the same God. Impossible. You know why? I'm not judging. Please understand. God, what did you say? He can never change. God is perfect. God is holy. So when God speaks, his word is eternal. His word cannot be contradictory. one thing here, another thing over there. His word is one and one only. So when God speaks in the Bible, He cannot be the same God that speaks in the Quran or in Buddhism or in Hinduism. It is impossible. Because all the religions in the world are contradictory to what Christianity is. I'm not judging. It's a fact. Read about Islam, read about Buddhism, Hinduism, Shintoism, nothing to do with Christianity. Because the heart of the Christian faith is that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, is God Himself, was revealed in the flesh, He suffered, He was crucified in the days of Pontius Pilate, He was buried, and on the third day rose from the dead and ascended and sat at the right hand of His Father. This is the faith and the heart of the Christian faith. If you do not believe in the same way, you're definitely not worshiping the same God. Impossible. So what do we need to do? We need to pray for everyone. We love everyone, but when it comes to speaking about Jesus Christ, there is no compromising. I gotta state what the truth is. In the truth, there is no hypocrisy. In the truth, there is no, let me twist this one a little bit. You know what, I don't wanna hurt your feelings, so I'm gonna try and be as soft as possible. No. Hey. It's about your salvation, my dear friend. Do you want me to paint it for you? No. You got to come and say, you're a sinner, brother. And if you don't confess your sins, you're in trouble. And Jesus is the only one. Jesus is the only one. Jesus is the only one. So the scroll is at the right hand of the one who sits on the throne. I'm not going to continue because I won't give it justice. We'll continue with that next week, God willing. But I'll leave you with this. Who's here for the first time? Welcome, welcome. I should have said that at the beginning. Very warm welcome. Are you here for the first time? I pray it's not the last time. My beloveds, everything that is tangible, everything that is seeable is temporal. The thing that you can see is only temporary. So when you see the water, it's temporary. When you see a tree, it is temporary. When you see a bird, it is temporary. When you see yourself, you see your neighbor. Everything you see is temporal. Whatever you cannot see is eternal. That's why St. Paul says, I urge you not to run after the things that you can see, but run and try to obtain the things you cannot see, because what you can see is temporal, but what you cannot see is eternal. When you stand and look at a fruitful tree, has any one of us, I'll say this to myself before I say it to no one else, anyone else. When we stand before a fruitful tree, have we ever stood before a beautiful fruitful tree and said, what a beautiful roots? Oh, look at this tree. Look at the branches. Look at the leaves. Look at the fruits, man. What a beautiful tree. But hang on. The beauty and the elegance of this tree is the roots of the tree. The roots must have been good. That's why the tree was good. If the roots were rotted, the tree would have been the ugliest, most rotted tree you could ever come across. But where are the roots? Underground, hidden. You cannot see them. What is hidden, that's where life lies. Christ is hidden in everyone. We need to acknowledge the one who is hidden in us, not the one who is visible to us. And until the day that comes when everyone acknowledges and focuses on the one who is hidden in them, there is no life in you, my dear friend. You are dying in your own sin. The world has gone haywire because the world is missing God. The world is missing God. We need our freedom. I'm gonna go to Canberra, man. Go the truckies. But you know what? It's a shame. It would be a shame if we gain our freedoms back and abuse it. Then what's the point? Is freedom defined as I can do whatever I want? Is that freedom? Is freedom being able to gamble your life away and take poisonous substances? Is that freedom? Is freedom going out in whichever way you want, to choose whichever gender you choose? Is that freedom? Is freedom abusing your well-being, abusing your very identity that makes you a human being? Is that freedom? What has become of mankind? God is missing. God is missing. My beloved daughters, especially the young ones who are 80 plus. I used to work in the bank in the golden days, in the Commonwealth Bank. Which bank? There was an ad on TV. Which bank? Commonwealth. The I Can Bank. No, only Jesus can claim that I can. None of you can. I used to work in the Commonwealth Bank, and on a pension day, Thursday, baby, all me girlfriends lined up, by the good-looking Aussie girls, 80 plus. She would come dressed up, makeup, the mascara, pascara, the foundation, the eyelashes, the nails, everything. And a beautiful hat on the side. She's going to the club, man. And she would come and say, "G'day, how you going? All right, how you going? Can I have 20 bucks and 50 cents and 20 cents? Because I know she's going to the club playing the pokies." Good old days. Good old days. Mobile was not around yet. Technology ruined a lot of things. And this Elon Musk wants to bring artificial intelligence everywhere. Go and live in Mars. Leave Earth alone. When a human being elevates above what they are worth, elevate above what they are worth, they lose their worth. Because when you elevate above what God has made you worth, you want to become God on earth? Now, this is a very psychopath mentality. Because no one can challenge God and live. No one. Today, seeking freedom, we've lost freedom. We became slaves to our own indulgences. Freedom lies in one place only. This sweetheart, Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Oh. Now I can say hallelujah to that. Jesus is good looking. Jesus is breathtaking. Jesus is sweet. Jesus is beautiful. Jesus is perfect. Jesus is complete. In Him, I am complete. In Him, I am beautiful. In Him, I am found. In Him, I live. In Him, I breathe. In Him, I walk. In Him, I move. In Him, I am. Whom He made me, me. Jesus is the answer to every question. Jesus is the medication to every illness. Jesus is the solution to every problem. Jesus is the way to every lost soul. Jesus is the breath of life to every dead soul. Jesus is home for me. And I encourage you to make Him your home today, if you haven't before. My beloveds, I beg of you. At the end of the day, all of us are human beings. Whether you are a prime minister, whether you are a premier, whether you are a politician, whether you are a religious figure, whether you are the Pope or the Patriarch or a good-looking bishop like me. That hit home. Whether you are a bishop, we are all human beings. Whether you are a carpenter, a cleaner, a doctor, a lawyer, a teacher, a professor, we are all human beings. We have lost touch of our humanity. We have lost touch of our humanity. The day we lose touch of our humanity, we cannot say, I believe. I beg of you. We cannot say, I believe. You're lying. When you read, and I'll leave you with this 100%. When you read in the Gospel of Luke, and you may have heard this from me before, and I'll say it again. When you read in the Gospel of Luke, speaking about Jesus Christ of Nazareth, all glory to His holy name. Saint Luke writes the following. He says, and Jesus used to grow in stature and in wisdom before God and men. I'll say it again. Jesus used to grow in stature and in wisdom before God and men. Stature, referring to the body. Wisdom, referring to the spirit. And this is the human being made out of two main components bound together by the third one that connects the two. The two main components that make a human being is body and spirit connected by something called the soul, S-O-U-L. One day I'm going to talk about this. That's an interesting topic. Jesus grew in stature. What grows in you? The body, the spirit doesn't. And I mean in the physical, in the tangible way, the spirit doesn't. The spirit doesn't come baby and then grows bigger, bigger. No, spirit is spirit. Doesn't grow. So what grows is the body. But listen, the Holy Bible is the author of the book. God is the author of this book. So He has a reason why He put the body before wisdom, the spirit. Some people say the body is nothing. The spirit that counts. You have not read the entire Bible thoroughly. You have not understood how God operates. The body is extremely important. Why? Because without the body, how are they going to know if you've got faith or not? They don't see the spirit, they see your body. Has anyone seen your spirit and said, oh, what a beautiful spirit you have? No. They say, oh, he's good looking. Oh, she's beautiful. Because they saw the body. It is through the body that you reflect God or you reflect evil. Jesus was growing in stature, body. Growing in stature meaning he was growing with morals, with values, with ethics, principles of life. Mother Mary taught him. And the Holy Spirit, God, taught him as a human being. But Mom also taught him. Mom said, son, we need to go to the temple. We need to give our offering. We need to give our tithing. We need to thank God for everything that He's given us. Son, you need to be nice to your neighbor. Son, you need to be nice to your friends. Son, you need to respect people. Son, this is the law and the commandment of God. My son, you need to show a beautiful behavioral pattern before everyone. When Jesus grew and became 30 years of age, why did people love this man so much? Why did they trust him so much? Why did they follow him so much? For one reason, they said it, we have never heard nor seen anyone that speaks and behaves like this one. They didn't say, we've never seen anyone raising the dead. We've never seen anyone doing the miracles. We've never heard anyone talk and speak like this man. He is all respect and dignity. We love this man for the way he behaves, for the way he acts, for the way he talks, for the way he walks. We love him. They loved God through the flesh, not the spirit. Today, people wanna behave immorally and then say, I have faith. Doesn't work, my dear friend. If you don't know how to talk, you will never know how to believe. Jesus is not after your faith. Jesus is after your behavior. My beloved, live a life of dignity. Live a life of principle and ethics. Have values in your life. And stand for those values. Stand firm. And the ultimate morals and values is they lie in this person, Jesus Christ of Nazareth. This man. I'll leave you with this. So the scroll was at the right hand of the one who sits on the throne. See, if you want to talk a little bit in depth, that was one verse. It's been an hour and almost 15 minutes. Just one verse. So how do you want me to talk? Like this or just brush through it? Brush through it? I promise you next time I'll brush through it. A wonderful soul sent me a message from Canada. I'm not going to mention their names. They sent me a message from Canada and they asked me to pray for Canada, for the people of Canada, because of what's happening there. And you probably have seen it all over the social media platforms, you know, all those truck drivers and thousands of people going to Ottawa and protesting against the tyranny or the tyranny of so-called government and government leaders. I could see Justin Trudeau or whatever, I don't know how to pronounce it, Trudeau maybe. Sounds like French, Trudeau, oh la la, Trudeau, very good. I could see this man needs a lot of prayers. I could say a lot of things about this man, but I won't. My Jesus did not teach me to reveal what people do and say behind the scenes, but I can. But I won't do it, because love covers a lot of errors. But I can say this man needs a lot of prayers. It takes God to save this soul. He's gone too far. And many leaders are like him. This country is in a lot of trouble. The people of this country and the leadership of this country is in a lot of trouble because they walked away from Jesus Christ. Don't call yourself a Pentecostal or a born again and I don't know what else. Listen, you need to grow up and wake up. And if you call yourself a Christian, then you better live up to it. And stop these acts, jumping and doing this and that. Stop this. Live up to it. Behave accordingly. Christianity is not an act. It's not a stage you go and play your game. You better live your Jesus Christ. And to the entire church, oh, and this other guy in France, Macron, or Macaroni, or Macaroni. You know, these people are really lost. How can you treat your own people like that? It's an absolute shame. Who gave you the jurisdiction and the authority? Just because you're president, you can bring force and destroy people's lives? You want to be jabbed, shut your mouth and go and get it. But leave the rest to their own choices. The body is not yours, President Macron. You look after your own life and let people live and choose whatever they want to choose. It's their body. They choose what to go in there and not to go in there. You cannot force it, neither you nor those who are bigger than you. Only God can, and God even didn't do that. We need to wake up. We need to wake up. Australia must wake up. We need Jesus Christ back in our lives. Look at America, what has become of it since they denied Jesus Christ more and more as the day went by. They took Jesus Christ out of their school system. They took Jesus Christ out of the medical system, out of the government system. The government now is very childish, acting very childishly. And to the church leaders, my dear friend, as a church leader, if you're a pope, if you're a patriarch, if you're a cardinal, if you're a bishop, if you're a church leader, on earth we only live once as Christians. I'm talking to you as Christians. On earth we only live once. The best way to leave this world is to leave as a hero, not as a coward. You need to leave as a brave man, not as one who has sold his master with 30 pieces of silver. Because at the end, when the spirit leaves the body, neither your rank, nor your wealth, nor your fame and prestigious life will come to your rescue. The only one who's going to come to your rescue is the blood of the Lamb of God, who was slain before the foundation of the world. Jesus is the only way. So, my dear friend, reevaluate where you and I are standing today. On whose side are you? Who did you make your portion? Is it God or is it Satan? Is it Jesus Christ or is it money? Because I could see the church nowadays is boasting about being rich in wealth, materialistic wealth, but not rich in spiritual wealth. The church is building so many things except the human being. Christ did not die for the brick and mortar. Christ did not die for the gold and the silver and the linen. Christ did not die for the precious stones. Christ died for you and me. So you better start building people for God, not bricks, not the dirt of the earth. Where are the church leaders? Go and get the jab, and you are showing an act of love to your neighbor. And if you don't get the jab, you are not showing an act of love to your neighbor. You know, what's funny, like, until now, they're still talking about boosters. Your game is over. Health ministers. Oh, the good old Anthony Fauci. And Mr. Tedros of the WHO, World Health Organization, WHO. FDA, CDC, BBC, KFC, FCC, DTT, woo-hoo-hoo. Mate, these people are lost. Anthony Fauci has been lying to the human race from the beginning of 2020. Bill Gates has been lying from the very beginning. Pfizer, he can stick it in his arm. What has become of the human race? Where is the human element? Where is the dignity and where is the identity of what makes up a human? I am seeing and watching aliens speaking. Absolute aliens. I cannot recognize humans. They must be from another planet. Even though my Bible does not say that, I don't believe in aliens, but I can see aliens walking on earth calling themselves human beings. And they have been honored and giving high positions, influential positions, yet they are not acting as humans. You know why? We lost touch of Jesus. Believe me, we lost touch of Jesus Christ. Church leaders, come back with a humble heart. Come back and unite with Christ first before you can unite with your brother. It's so easy to stand here at the pulpit and preach the gospel. Very easy. But it's not easy to live with the person you are talking about. Christianity is not just talks. You need to live with Christ. So all those who preached and jumped up and down and shouted hallelujah when this pandemic came, where were you? All of you went quiet. All of you supported this evil agenda. And all of you went with the flow and got the money, baby. And all of you encouraged your followers to go and do whatever the government is saying to you. So where was Jesus then? You sold him? Is that Christianity? The Lord lives forever. His word endures forever. The Lord is the truth. He is the way, the truth, and the life. He is the Alpha and the Omega. He is the first and the last. He is the beginning and the end. There is no one before him, neither after him. He is the one and only. He is God revealed in the flesh, the creator of everything that is visible and invisible. The spiritual and the physical, tangible realms are his creation. His name is Jesus Christ of Nazareth, the love of my life, my sweetheart. I love this man. I adore this man. I goody-goody this man. I eat his heart, his lungs, his kidneys. I buy him fish burger and a chocolate sundae, Macca's drive-thru, baby. He is the Aussie of my life. He is my Aussie, he is my hero, he is my everything. He is the one and only. Come back to Jesus and see what the Lord is going to do. All of this will be washed away. America, come back to the Lord before China takes over. I'll tell you what will happen later on. But just a sneak preview. If America doesn't repent now, very soon it'll be gone. No comeback. No more superpower. The next superpower will be China, supported by Russia. They will go into the Middle East and they will smash the head of the Jews, Israel. You can be allies now for as long as you want. That won't be. Because he who denies Jesus Christ will be smacked. You can be as friend as much as you want. One day, before you know it, you'll become the worst enemies ever. It is only Jesus that keeps that friendship endures forever. Protects that love forever. Come back to Jesus Christ, America. And every nation, Europe, my goodness, what has become of Germany, Sweden, the Netherlands, Spain, all of Europe, what happened to it? Where is Jesus Christ? Have you forgotten about him? You've become an atheistic, secular governments and world. So sad. God gave us a beautiful creation, and look what we're doing to it. We are destroying it. Did you know Bill Gates and George Soros, they bought a massive piece of land in America to grow their own veggies filled with poison and sell to the world. Inject them with poison and export it all to the world. Let humanity eat and die. Cancer increasing. Autism. Every third child is autistic. What happened? The poor baby is just a piece of little piece of flesh injecting them with these chemicals. How is the brain going to tolerate that? Little minute baby. The world is evil. But there is one who has and is the antidote to this poison. His name is Jesus Christ. You need his precious blood. Come to Christ, my beloved. I love you, but Jesus loves you the most. Be happy, for as long as the Lord lives, we shall live in him and with him forever. Amen. Let's stand for the finale prayer, please. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, one God. Amen. Lord, make me an instrument of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. Where there is sadness, joy. O Divine Master, grant that I may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive. It is in pardoning that we are pardoned. It is in dying that we are born again to eternal life. Amen. May the Lord Jesus bless you, guide you, and protect you all the days of your life, now and forevermore. Amen. I shall see you next week, God willing. Enjoy the weekend that's coming up. Be happy in the Lord and be strong, for Jesus is with us always. God bless you.
Standing here before you, resting in your heavenly glory. Let your will be done for me. I cast my burdens onto you, Lord, knowing you will take them all. I'm trusting in your blood you shed for me. I know you've covered all my sins. I'm standing days, you're with me, yeah. You have always been my strength. I cast my burdens onto you, Lord, and knowing you will take them all. I'm trusting in blood you shed for me. I know you've covered all my sins. I'm standing here in victory, knowing you have done it all. You're deserving of the glory. Let us praise your holy name. Lord, we shall worshiping your